Oh.
Alrighty, folks. So right now it's a little bit past six, so we're gonna get started. So this is part of our monthly series called It Depends, where I bring in my SARE advisor homies, my volunteer homies, Tony and Davis, to give us the lowdown on anything that's related to taxes and for legal, for real estate. And so for those who aren't really familiar with us, we've been doing this for the last couple months already, so it's kind of like you don't have an excuse, but we just recently had Davis and Tony come up to SearCon, where they shared a lot of interesting things for us. So we're really, for this series, we just really go into more detail. And then also this is an opportunity for you guys to ask questions, because I know you guys are Asian, meaning you're probably too cheap to go and hire someone to ask questions. So this is my way of bringing my friends and answering questions for you guys. And then also for a goodie that you guys might not know about, is that Davis and Tony are about to start a small cohort of students. I think the maximum is around, what, 15 students or so per cohort. So it'll be intimate. It'll be 6 weeks of classes. That's what meets on Sundays. And so there'll also be an opportunities for you guys to ask questions and have like a community that's really dedicated to helping you guys make sure you're set up properly for taxes and for legal. So this is really designed for real estate investors, because I volunteered them to make something like this. So the next cohort is starting on September 17th. So if you guys are interested in joining, go ask Davis or Tony. And then if it fills up, then we'll try and see if we can start another one, another cohort later in the year. So without further ado, I'm gonna pass the torch over to my homie Davis to take this over on why do you need an operating agreement? Take it over, Davis.
Thanks. Thanks, Annie. Before I get started, is this screen a little small?
Yep.
Okay. I'm gonna try to fix that real quick because I got this new monitor that's like vertical, and then I think I messed it up, but I was like, I'm
Or
just
just
gonna be
turn
looking
your
off
head
to the
this way.
side then though. So let's
Turn
see.
your head this way and watch the whole thing. Okay,
That Sorry, everybody. Facebook thing.
All right, go for it.
Right, so today we're going to talk about operating agreements, like more specifically why you need one if you have like an LLC. I'm going to try to keep it a little bit general and open for questions because in terms of an operating agreement and the type of provisions you have included in it, it really varies and there's no like actual requirement in terms of how many provisions or what you really need to include, right? So we can go on through like a list of, we can talk for like 4 hours and talk about like every single provision and every single event that has occurred in the past to include so that we can, prevent ourselves from having that type of issue. But I'm going to talk about the main issues that people usually face, the major provisions that you should include so that at least if you guys did somehow use like an operating agreement that you found online or use like a third party for, you can kind of make sure that you include specific provisions so that you are protected. So, why do you need an operating agreement? Disclaimer, of course, receiving this information today in this presentation doesn't create any type of attorney-client relationship between yourself and myself or my firm. This is simply for just free educational information. So, nothing provided should be considered legal advice. As everyone's situation is different, of course, consult with your own attorney, accountant, or tax professional, such as Tony, with any specific questions that you guys might have. Because, like I said, not all of this information applies to everybody. I am a licensed attorney in California, so most of my information is going to pertain to California law. However, as California likes to be really strict and extensive, most likely it's going to apply in your respective state. But what you want to do is you want to make sure you go to see what the rules might be in your state that you're in. or the state that you have your LLC in, as some states don't actually even require an operating agreement. However, it's highly recommended that you do have one, or else it's going to default to the state rules. So the agenda for today, I can talk about like some components of an operating agreement, of course, why it's important. And I've added a couple other specific provisions that, you know, people in the real estate industry usually like to include in the operating agreements. Briefly talking about joint ventures, because I thought that that's what we were going to discuss today. But joint ventures are not an LLC. It's more of like a temporary partnership between two parties or two or more parties. So everything we talk about in regards to an operating agreement should be, I advise that you should include in like your joint venture agreement or partnership agreement. And then lastly, we'll have some time for some question and answers. So operating agreement, what is an operating agreement, right? It's a document that lays out the business's internal and operational affairs. You might want to consider it to be more so like the constitution or like the Bible for your LLC. Typically in corporations, it's called a bylaw, but for LLCs, it's an operating agreement. Now in California, you are required by law to have an operating agreement. And for people that are located in other states or that have LLCs in other states, of course, check your Secretary of State website for the requirements, whether or not you do need one. Like I said earlier, even if your state doesn't require you to have one, it's highly recommended that you do have one because it's going to dictate how the LLC is going to operate. Yes, typically you want to make sure that all the members sign this operating agreement. You won't believe how many times I come into instances where, you know, my clients send me their operating agreement that needs revision or an amendment, or they get involved in a lawsuit. And the OA was drafted, you know, maybe like 5-10 years ago when the LLC was created, but it's not signed by all the members because everyone likes to get excited. But I'm creating an LLC with partners, think it's going to be like a short-term, temporary, you know, business partnership or whatnot, and they forget to sign. So typically, I mean, if nothing happens and you dissolve it, I guess dissolve it properly, nothing really happens. But in the case that there is an issue, which is the purpose of why we have one in the first place, if you don't have it signed, it's going to be harder to enforce, as the other party might say, oh, this was just a draft. I never agreed to this. So in California, like I said, no requirement to file with the state. It's an internal document, but it is required to have by law. So single or multi-member LLC, typically you might think that, oh, I have a single member LLC. Do I even need an operating agreement? Because, you know, I'm the 100% owner. I call the shots. I decide what's going to happen. You know, my vote is the only vote, but yes, you should have, you are required to have one still, as it's an operating agreement is more so an internal document that you might need to show in a lawsuit, which is going to state pretty much that your LLC was operating as a separate entity. And it's not just pretty much, you know, you doing everything. You're trying to separate yourself from the entity. So the entity should have its own rules, even if it sounds ridiculous that you're stating that you had a meeting with yourself and you voted and, you know, whatnot. So for multi-members and single members, you still need an operating agreement. So certain terms and provisions you want to make sure that you have within your operating agreement. So of course you want to discuss or include membership ownership interests, pretty much equity, like who owns what percentage of the LLC, the duties and responsibilities of members and managers, distributions of profits and losses, you know, how you guys are going to distribute your profits, how you guys are going to handle your losses, financial and operational procedures of the LLC, voting rights and responsibilities of each member, the rules and procedures for holding meetings, right? Buyout and buy and sell procedures. So if you are going to be selling potentially like your interest in the LLC, what are the rules? Is there like right of first refusal? Is there restrictions to transfers or selling of your interest? You want to make sure you have all that included. Your capital contributions, which are going to be the amount of money that you're actually investing into the LLC to make sure that it's getting started and properly funded. This is actually really important because I'm going to talk about it a little bit more later. But if you don't have an operating agreement in general, in California, it's going to defer to a RUCA, which is the Revised Uniform Limited Liability Company Act. And what that states is, if you don't include capital contributions or the membership interest of every member of the LLC, they're just simply just going to say, okay, everyone has equal share. So even if somebody has 90% and the other person has 10%, if you don't have an operating agreement, and then what's going to happen is you guys are both going to split 50-50 of the profits. So I'm sure you're not going to want that. So you want to make sure you include that. Of course, important tax status, whether it's going to be sole proprietorship, if it's a partnership, S Corp, C Corp, you want to make sure you include this in the operating agreement. You want to make sure that it's going to be identical to whatever you put in the articles of organization. And when you file like with the IRS, your tax election, you just want to make it clear that, you know, you're going to be electing a specific status, and that's going to correlate to the operating agreement. You want to include things about amendments. For instance, when you want to amend the operating agreement, you know, what's the proper protocol? Do you have to have a vote? Drag along provisions, meaning that do the majority ownership members have the ability to simply drag along the minority members when it comes to certain decisions? Are they required to like sell their interest if the majority sells? Bargaining order provisions, which is important. I mean, it's a little bit harder to enforce in California, but it's highly recommended that you just still include it. So that, let's say that one member of your LLC has a separate issue and gets involved in a lawsuit, creditors now has a judgment against them and is now trying to require you to sell your LLC. By having specific charging order provisions, you can state that, you know, nobody's really allowed to be selling off their interest in terms of like, you know, paying off creditors, even if it's a judgment. However, they're only going to be able to take the distributions or the profits that that member is entitled to. So at least you can still make sure that the LLC is operating, the company is operating how it was originally designed to, and you're not really required to sell the whole LLC. You're simply stating that, you know, okay, well, this person's profits, you know, yes, we can give those to the creditors, but it's going to be a lot harder for a creditor to try to enforce the sale of the LLC in case, let's say, the judgment is, you know, in a large amount compared to how much the members make. You want to include provisions regarding like death of a member. What's going to happen is going to just simply go down to their family members. Is it going to be distributed? Is the LLC simply just going to buy out the interest of the deceased member and give it to their estate or their family? And dissolution, of course, the proper protocol, what's going to happen when you guys dissolve or wind down. So why would you want an operating agreement? So first off, of course, it protects and maintains limited liability status. So in California, like I stated, it's required by law to have an operating agreement. So if you don't have an operating agreement, then you're losing your limited liability protection, which is primarily one of the main reasons why you're creating an LLC to begin with, right? So like I've kind of always mentioned, if you're gonna go through and create an LLC and pay, you know, the franchise taxes and adhere to all the rules and regulations and requirements that are required out of you, if you have an LLC, you might as well make sure you're doing it right. You don't want to, you know, pretty much do 90% of the work and not do 10% and have that pretty much screw you over, right? So if you want that limited liability protection, you do need to have an operating agreement. Otherwise, the court's just going to see you as more so a sole proprietor. And it might be requested by lenders and other businesses, right? Of course, when you open up a bank account, when you're trying to get a loan, of course, they always ask for the operating agreement. And the reason for that is for them to see that you're actually a legitimate business entity, and also to just confirm that the individual that's making this decision actually has the right to be acting on behalf of the LLC, which should also be included in the operating agreement as well. It minimizes disputes and business disruptions by being clear with your partners and members in terms of, you know, what everyone's duties and responsibilities are. And what's going to happen if one person wants to sell their interest or sell off, et cetera. You're minimizing, you know, any delays or business disruptions that might occur, right? Because if somebody wants out and, you know, you have it clearly listed out exactly what's going to happen in terms of when they want out, then you can kind of make sure you adhere to that and business can operate as usual versus now be stuck in a limbo where now you guys are just in a lawsuit against each other or now having to force to close the business down because you guys can't come to an agreement. So the best way to prepare for that is to just prepare in advance and try to predict all types of outcomes that might exist in the future or that might happen in the future so that, you know, you're not disrupted and that there's no real dispute. It's more so, okay, well, we agreed to do this initially, so let's just, that's the route we're going to take. A succession plan, like I said, for in case you pass away or if you know you're too old and you want to retire and you'd want to have the opportunity to potentially have somebody replace you. You want to make sure you include all these things in an operating agreement so that there's a smooth transition. Establishes credibility. I mean, this is probably one of the reasons why you're even creating an LLC to begin with, right? Because sometimes you don't want to be a sole proprietor. And what I said before, if you want to have an LLC, then you want to make sure you have an operating agreement. One of the most important things is that you want to have an operating agreement because you can avoid governance by the state's default rules. Like I said earlier, in California, it's the RUCA, which has a lot of terms that might protect you, but at the end of the day, it's not necessarily suitable for a lot of people's situations. And you also don't want the state's default rules to apply. For instance, when I stated earlier that the state's default rule is that all members have equal ownership. So let's say you have like 10 investors and it's actually like only two of them own like 80% and the others have like 5 or 10% each. If you don't have an operating agreement, it's just going to say state pretty much that everyone has 10%. So some consequences of poor drafting of an operating agreement, whether you don't have one at all, or if you're simply just using a random one that you found, or just you decided you wanted to draft it yourself and you know you didn't do the greatest job doing it. Like I think Tony can explain to you guys, he likes to draft his operating agreements, so he might maybe be able to give you guys some input on mistakes that he may have made. But some consequences of poor drafting. The power to approve or control the business is too broad or general. This is when you include certain provisions that state like, hey, like this manager or this member can do whatever the heck they want, right? Now, of course, that sounds good, but unless you're a single member, you probably don't want to give those rights to specific managers or members, right? So you want to make sure that the power to approve or to specific persons is clearly laid out with the responsibilities and duties that they have. Because a lot of times members and also managers can abuse their powers, right? So you want to be more definitive in terms of what exactly can this manager do? What exactly can this member do, right? Of course, sometimes it is very difficult to have a list of every single thing they can do, every single thing that they can't do, because you don't want a situation where now like the manager has to get a membership, the members to agree that he can use his credit card for any expense that's over $100. You know, everyone's busy, but there are certain limitations and there are certain things that we can include that specifically state like, hey, any expense that are over like $500, $1,000, whatever does require like a written consent or things of that nature from the other members. Distributions that are not clearly established, right? So if we don't specifically include that people are getting certain distributions, then a lot of problems can occur, right? Because especially in real estate where a lot of times there's passive investors or passive partners, and there's the people that are actually managing and working for sweat equity. We want to make sure that everyone's clear in terms of whether there's just going to be distributions that are going to be paid out and what that proportions are going to be. You want to include, like, for instance, like when the distributions are made, right? Because I'm sure you guys are, you know, familiar with real estate investments and projects, and especially like with flips, things never go according to plan. There's always delays. So if there's specific language in the operating agreement that says, hey, like every year this has to happen, that then you might come across some issues if you guys aren't able to complete the project within a year. So you want to include specific language that say, hey, like this is the times when distributions can be made. This is how it's going to be done. Distributions are going to be made. Sometimes there's loans, right? Investors give out loans. So you want to clearly state that, hey, distributions are made after the initial loan that was paid by this specific member is paid out in full first and things of that nature. And yes, I want to emphasize what I said earlier is if you don't have specific language, then there's a chance that distributions get paid out equally. So that's not, I mean, that's good for somebody that has minority interests. But if you have majority, that's something you clearly want to avoid. Some other consequences, so increases exposure to outside liability. So if you don't have one or if it's poorly drafted, there's a lot of times where creditors can argue that, hey, you have specific provisions that you should have included in your operating agreement, but you didn't include. So now we're just going to apply ROLCA. And that states that we can do this, for instance, like charging orders, right? If you don't include it, they can try to, and there's no language stating in your operating agreement that in terms of like what happens if there's like debts from like a specific member outside of their role in this specific LLC, then they can try to actually just sell your LLC. So in order to prevent things of that nature and to protect yourself from outside creditors, from businesses or, you know, lawsuits that the member is a part of that has nothing to do with this LLC, you want to make sure you're including specific language such as charging orders. Also, it can open up a pool of unknown members who have interest in your company. So if you don't include specific things like, you know, right of first refusal, buy sell provisions, that gives the ability for the member to pretty much sell their interest to anybody. The next thing you know, you might just have random people that have a lot of say in your LLC, and that might make it difficult for you to operate and for you to conduct business to what you guys originally created this LLC for. Now, typically, most operating agreements, they will include right of first refusal, meaning that the LLC has the first right to pretty much purchase the interest before they go off to like a third party and sell it. But there are actually a lot of operating agreements that are silent on this. So you just want to make sure that you restrict, of course, you want to all agree amongst the members, but that would be kind of expected because they're going to be the ones reading it and signing it. But you want to collectively agree upon what the restrictions are going to be in terms of transferring and selling your interest in the LLC, because you know, oftentimes you go into business with specific people, and the last thing you'd want is to be in an LLC, a manager of an LLC with three people you don't even know of. It exposes the business to IRS liability. Inconsistent language regarding the actual tax status of your LLC will increase exposure because they might say, hey, you know, you said you were electing to be this, but this operating agreement says that you're not. And we haven't received the filing because, you know, the IRS is typically very slow to even confirm anything of your elections, whatnot. So there can be a lot of inconsistencies and that will create more exposure for you. Some important decisions can remain stagnant by not designating, you know, how decisions can be made and by whom, right? Whether it's by like vote, unanimous decision, majority, or if the manager just gets to decide, it's going to reduce productivity. A lot of, you know, times where it's going to be stagnant, you know, and then you're going to have everybody meet to try to make decisions on specific things. Management and voting rights. So you want to clearly state if it's going to be member managed or manager managed, right? So member managed means that all members of the LLC are serving as the role of a manager. A manager managed means you guys can either designate one member or multiple members or even a third outside party to be a manager of the LLC. Now in California, if you don't have this stated, it's going to default to state that all members are managed. So if you are going to elect a manager, you want to make sure that you do so and specifically state that in the operating agreement. Voting rights, and this is important too, because you know, you want to clearly state, you know, what decisions need to be made. And you can always separate it, as in certain decisions can be done on like unanimous decision, certain things can be done in majority vote. Sometimes a lot of issues that, you know, my clients have is they have a hard time trying to equal the playing ground because, let's say, for instance, there's two members, one member has 60% interest, the other two have like 20-20. Now, of course, if you simply just put majority, that one person can make the decisions on behalf, even if two members don't agree to it. So sometimes you want to make it unanimous. You can also make it where it's the vote, it's by person, meaning everyone has the same equal vote. So it'd be more so like two versus one versus just one person with more membership interest being able to make all the decisions. Now, if you don't have an operating agreement for Rulka, it's going to state that you need unanimous voting for any amendments to the OA or the Statement of Information or Organization, Articles of Organization. So that means that somebody with 1% interest in the LLC or 2% interest can pretty much state that you can't make any changes to the original operating agreement. Now, a lot of times for OAs, as LLCs and for businesses, as they expand, bring on other investors, every time you bring on a new member, you're technically supposed to be revising and amending your operating agreement. But if there's somebody that has like 1% interest stating that, nope, I don't agree, nope, like that can happen, that's obviously going to cause a lot of trouble for the LLC. So you want to make sure you clearly state the voting rights for the decisions and how the LLC is going to operate. So this is just like a quick list, you know, just for you to consider, you know, as you look at your OA, maybe things that should be included. I think I'm pretty sure I covered most of this. Yeah, identification of the members and managers, registered agents. As a member, especially if you're a minority member, you want to make sure you ask for like the actual operating agreement and make sure you're actually listed on it in terms of what interest you have. Because technically, if you're not listed on the Statement of Information or the Articles of Organization with the Secretary of State, which not all members are, actually, they don't actually have to be listed on it. So you want to make sure that since the operating agreement is the only document that really governs, that really this details the operations and the interest of the LLC, you want to make sure your name's actually on that. Contributions, the capital contributions, you know, your membership interest and how you're going to allocate profits and losses, the business purpose, distribution method, roles and responsibilities, transfer restrictions. Now, this is typically when I advise my real estate investors when creating LLCs and drafting operating agreements. This is a difficult component because sometimes when people are eager to get a project going, they want to form the LLC, but they don't necessarily know exactly what everyone's roles and responsibilities are going to be, especially with a lot of times these projects where everyone has to just kind of all hands on deck and do whatever is needed. To your best extent, you want to make sure you can list out exactly what certain people are responsible for, right? And if you aren't going to be responsible for anything, meaning you're simply a silent investor or a silent partner, you're kind of just putting the capital contribution, more capital contribution than the others. You want to clearly state that you don't have specific responsibilities and that your role is literally just you were the person who was putting the money down, because what often happens is, you know, partnerships always, or LLCs or partnerships, when you go into projects or, you know, investments with partners, everyone's all happy because we all think that everyone's going to make money. But a lot of the times this isn't the case, right? Things always go sour or something always goes wrong and there needs to be adjustments made. But if you don't clearly state what your role and responsibility is, then it subjects you to a lot of exposure and liabilities and potentially your partners potentially telling you like, hey, you didn't fulfill this. So now we're filing a lawsuit against you because you kind of breached your duties, et cetera, and we're not going to give you the money that you're actually entitled to, right? So you want to make sure that you specifically lay out what your responsibilities are to protect yourself and also to keep your other partners accountable for their roles when operating this business or LLC. Manager and member removal. This is very important too, because oftentimes one person's simply going to say, hey, I'll be the manager because I have the most time. Other members are just for the sake of, hey, I don't want to do extra work. So yeah, you can be the manager. But if the manager has more powers, more abilities to kind of dictate or operate the business, now you're at their mercy. And also if the operating agreement doesn't specifically state that the manager can be removed or the removal policy or the procedure, then now this LLC is going to be stuck with this manager being the manager, even if all the members don't like that. Books and record keeping, your voting rights, dispute resolution, how you guys are going to handle like disputes, whether that's internally amongst the members or external, if you guys get sued or again involved in a lawsuit. Now, oftentimes for LLCs, there will be certain provisions like indemnity provisions stating that, hey, if you know someone gets sued due to their, I guess, their actions taken on behalf of the LLC, and it's kind of proven that it wasn't actually their fault, it was a frivolous lawsuit, or if you guys prevail, then any expense that's kind of spent by the individual member, the LLC will reimburse that member. So that way you can kind of give yourself some protection there too. And then, like I've said, you know, buyouts, you know, the provisions needed for that in terms of, you know, are you guys going to just do a fair market appraisal? Does the company have right of first refusal? And if the company doesn't want to purchase it, then is there any limitations or restrictions on who they can sell their interest to and for what price? So specific provisions that might be more specific to real estate investors. So property acquisition details, right? Like for instance, like title and LLC's name, who's responsible for executing the documents on behalf of the LLC, and who's responsible for managing this the properties. This is, like I said, more so for the scenario where there's going to be an elected manager who's more responsible for like property management and things of that nature. So the purpose, so when you include like the business purpose in the operating agreement, you want to be as specific in regards to what type of business your LLC is going to operate in. Now, sometimes I think for real estate, like holding companies, real estate investment companies, if you guys are creating LLCs for like real estate flips, projects, investing, it's good to keep it somewhat general in the sense of, hey, you know, this company is going to be conducting real estate investments and purchasing, investing, renting, blah, 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 versus just stating, hey, this LLC is going to be conducting rental properties for the property located at 123 Front Main Street, like Brea, California, because then you're going to run across issues that this LLC should not be investing in other properties and was the specific purpose was simply to manage that property. But because a lot of people like to have LLCs and do different, you know, have real estate investments and do multiple projects, you want to keep it like specific, but somewhat general as well. Who has control of day-to-day, right? So if you're going to designate a manager to oversee the day-to-day, establish budgets, negotiate deals on behalf of the LLC, you want to make sure that you include specific language that like limits and restricts them from going beyond what the other members want them to do. Capital call and distributions, that's an important one because sometimes, you know, of course, the initial investment into the LLC it's insufficient, you know, there's delays, construction costs increase, things of that nature. So sometimes LLCs run out of money, right? And what's gonna happen? Who's gonna bring in the extra funds? Is there gonna be a capital call that requires all the members to invest their proportion in terms of their membership interest to offset like additional funds that are needed? What's the right protocol for that, right? And also distributions, right? How it's going to be done. And are you guys agreeing that, hey, 50% of the profits from this flip or this project is going to be kept and we're going to use that to invest in another property? Or are you guys simply going to be distributing everything equally based on membership interest? And then most importantly, exit strategy. So when you guys get rid of maybe like when you guys sell the property or you guys, you know, want to leave or people, specific members want out, for whatever reason, whether they need funds, et cetera, You want to make sure that you, you know, appoint the appropriate remedies or extra strategies to avoid deadlock, right? And just thinking of this early on is just a lot easier. And, you know, oftentimes, you know, my clients think, hey, like, it's just a quick flip. It's just going to be a 1-year project, blah, blah, blah. We don't need to think of a strategy because we know exactly what's going to happen. The purpose of having things like this is to prepare for the worst. So it's more so making sure that you're protecting yourself in case something that might be uncommon or something that you guys originally don't intend to do actually occurs, right? So you want to make sure you even include, hey, the goal obviously is to, let's just sell this project in 1 year and distribute it equally. But in case you don't, in case one person passes away, in case they have a change of heart, in case one person abandons, you want to make sure you have a specific strategy that both, that all parties of the LLC or all members agree to so that you can prevent any delays or issues down the road. And then I just want to briefly discuss joint ventures. Joint venture is more so like a business arrangement, more like a partnership where two or more parties combine their resources. A lot of times real estate investors actually opt for joint ventures instead of actually forming an LLC together. This is more common for like flips because they're thinking, hey, the goal is that it doesn't last too long. So let's just quickly do this and just split the profits, blah, 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 do this. It's not an actual entity. It's more so just like a kind of, it's like a collaboration. Like let's say when like two brands do a collaboration for a specific event, that's kind of what a joint venture is. But I do think a lot of the terms that we discussed and provisions that we discussed that you should include in an operating agreement, you should include in a joint venture agreement or partnership agreement as well. Because a lot of times these joint venture agreements are lacking of these very important provisions that will only benefit the two of you, or the partners of this joint venture. So just some quick information on joint ventures, you know, just in case you guys want to take a look at this while I'm not going to talk about it actually. So enough time, you can always pause it on YouTube and on Facebook. So, yep, that's pretty much it. So I think I want to open it up for Q&As.
Cool, I have one. So I'm looking at all the questions you have. They're really, really specific. And of course, the more specific, the more useful, the more powerful it is. But for someone who's just starting out doing their first LLC, I don't think they'll know how to think of these questions. And so how do you suggest that they start working with their attorneys to figuring out, you know, what answers these might be? Because they might not even understand the consequences of whatever their decisions are.
I think that kind of goes to why you even hire like a professional or an attorney in the first place, right? Is because you're hoping that they provide you with insight and this information and things that you should consider. And for peace of mind, right? Is I completely agree with you. A lot of times people say, oh, when they talk to me and they look at my questionnaire, they will say like, oh, I didn't even think about this, you know, like, and that, I think that just goes with the fact of, you know, finding an attorney or professional that, you know, has more experience in the type of businesses or deals that you're trying to do so that they can kind of guide you. And unfortunately, sometimes a lot of attorneys, even myself, you know, we haven't come across every single problem or issue, right? So it's kind of one of the things as you just learn as you go. So oftentimes I actually learn from clients as well when they say, yeah, I had this situation in this project or this business when, you know, this partner decided to do this. And it was an uncommon thing that you don't really typically find in most operating agreements, right? So, I mean, hopefully that answers your question. I mean, I think you can always even Google, you can Google, hey, about provisions to have in an operating agreement for the type of business you want to do, right? The type of provisions you want in operating or for real estate investing or amongst partners. And then there should be a ton of things that come out. But of course, with Google, the problem is there's just way too much information to consume, which is why I think maybe talking to your fellow friends, people in SARE, right? Or talking to your attorney, CPA about, hey, what are certain questions or certain provisions I should include in the operating agreement? So a lot of attorneys actually, when they create operating agreements, they will have questionnaires for you to fill out. And what I do at my firm is we have one for business and real estate. And within real estate, there's like multiple ones that I send out because I think it's more so important to have specific provisions that are asked and answered and included in the operating agreement versus like the just general ones that you find on like Legal Doom and stuff, you know?
Yeah, and it's true that just for those who don't know that Davis did actually create an operating agreement for myself. And it was a really, really long questionnaire that I was ghosting for weeks because like I didn't understand a lot of it. And like I had to ask Davis and like, what does it mean? Some of the questions sound really similar, but apparently things can turn very different. So it is important to go through that carefully questionnaire and then also with your partner separately. And then kind of compare to see which questions are different and then kind of reconcile all of those, because it was really helpful to have that just because as a newbie, we didn't know what we were getting into. So
I'm always the party pooper. I always just designate myself as the party pooper because it's like people come into partnerships and they're all thinking about only the good stuff. And hey, we're going to crush this business. We're going to crush this investment, blah, blah, blah. And then my job is the ones like I always give them the questionnaires that are like, hey, what do you want to do when you die? Hey, what do you want to do if your partner says like, screw you and decides to like, just leave and abandon the business, not pay what they were supposed to pay. So I'm the one that like brings like all the truths and then just the reality, right? So, but I think that's like one of the most important things, right? Is because usually if there were no disputes, if there were no problems that existed, then, you know, you probably don't even need an operating agreement. Right? Or any type of partnership agreement. But the purpose of this is so that there's not less issues, but there's a faster, more efficient resolution to issues that occur commonly, right, that you're planning ahead of, so that, you know, that way, if you both agree upon it, it's hard to say, hey, I never agreed to it that we were going to dissolve our LLC this way when it's clearly stated and you signed it, right? And one thing I forgot to mention is, earlier when I said that, of course, every member has to sign the operating agreement and amendment, is that, you know, some people ask, hey, do I need to get this notarized? But you don't need to get it notarized. But I always say, if you have that doubt about your partner or your investment partner, or you feel like they might be, you heard bad stuff, or they might be shady, and they might say, that's not my signature, or I never agreed to this, then it might be worth just getting it notarized, because they can't say it wasn't me when, you know, it was notarized that you're the one that signed the agreement.
And then after they sign it, do they usually like leave a signed copy with the firm, or it's just whatever that they have on their own?
Yeah. So it's always good to have a copy of the operating agreement in like the principal place of business. So wherever the business is located, and also for every member to have a copy of. Of course, the firm that, you know, creates this for you should have it. I mean, we usually keep ours open because a lot of times members, they forget it, or now it's years down the road. So they're like, it's too deep in the weeds for them to find out or pull out from their inboxes. So they can always ask, hey, can you send us like the executed agreement? And we do provide that. So I think it should only be really held by the business itself, the members, and the attorney or professional who's, you know, creating it or drafting it for you.
Great. Question in the chat is, if the property is owned by a trust and there are co-owners in that trust and property, do they need an operating agreement?
Wait, where is this? Is this in the Zoom chat or the Facebook chat?
Zoom chat by TT.
Okay, let me read it so that I think I like to read. It seems very specific and many newbies would, oh, that's your question, right? If the property is owned by a trust and there are co-owners in that trust, do we need an operating agreement in this case? Well, an operating agreement is only needed if there's an actual LLC. So if you have a trust, typically trusts you don't need to have an operating agreement in the trust. The living trust itself should pretty much should have provisions within the trust that state the things that you want implemented. Now, if, for instance, there's like 50% is owned by a trust, 50% is owned by a different LLC, then of course that LLC that owns 50% should have an operating agreement. Was that the question, or maybe like there was like a different question? So,
hi, can you hear me?
Yeah.
So okay, so this deal is actually a subject to. So my coach technically put that house under a trust, and then the beneficiary is her and then two other people. So I was just wondering, do they need an operating agreement in case of anything, you know, happen relating to repair, things like that later on?
So just to clarify, it's a subject to deal. And are you saying that the seller has the property in the trust, or the buyer?
The buyer is purchasing
it under the trust. Okay, so yeah. They're transferring title to the trust, correct?
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then you're
technically, they're not going to go through title. They just deed the house. They just change the owner names to the trust. You know, they just deed that house to the trust.
But if they deed the house, so for subject to, sometimes they change title after the final payment. Sometimes they do it before, right? As the buyer, you're going to want to do it like immediately, because you're never guaranteed that title is going to change, or you don't know when the seller might die or have a change of heart, etc. So when you record it, so you're saying that there's a deed, but the deed isn't recorded.
They only record the deed. So on the deed, it just shows that the trust name, that's it. And then
but if you record the deed, that does change that already changes the title. So
So it's okay. So she technically recorded herself. She technically just go to the court and then just submitted it, you know, instead of go through a title company.
Yeah. Oh no. So title just means like who actually owns the property.
Oh right? Yeah.
And when you record a deed, whether it's like a grant or whichever deed you decide.
She recorded the deed. Yes. But
so
I don't think she recorded the trust. So the trust that created technically is for that specific house, have a different trustee, which is her related, her relative, and then three beneficiaries.
So of course, like with the limited facts you're giving me right now, I can't really give you like legal advice, but what I think you're asking is that, I mean, so you kind of want to think of it separately, right? So you recorded the deed, so now the title is held by that trust for that property, okay?
Right.
And then within that, the trust itself, the document, the trust, it should dictate like, hey, the beneficiaries are these people, the trustees are these people, and this is how like the proceeds from this house is going to go to this, or who's going to be allowed to live in the house, etc. So in this case, there is no LLC involved at all, so you would not need an operating agreement.
Okay.
Certain terms, I think what you were maybe like thinking about is certain terms that you might find in an OA, you might want to include in this specific trust, if this trust is simply just created for the purposes of this property.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So just the short answer is, no, a trust, you do not need an operating agreement.
Okay.
And then, so,
I think there's a question in there, someone versus trust instead of LLC. So this coach, actually, she's got a lot of mentor right now to me. So she had like a series LLC, so an LLC on the top. And then she had like three or four series LLC underneath that LLC. And then each series LLC, she had trust. Mm-hmm. And each trust own a house.
Yeah, well, these are different like asset protection strategies that a lot of people use to kind of offset, like to get tax benefits or simply to kind of shield their assets, right? So these are more strategies. But within that like actual living trust, there's the living trust that specifically lays out the provisions that say like who the trustor is, trustees, beneficiaries, et cetera, are. And then the LLCs are primarily used to limit the liability. So that LLC should have an operating agreement. So that's kind of a common strategy people do, is they'll create a trust for the purposes of avoiding
probate.
Yeah,
the trust under is actually revocable though. They're not living trust. I don't think so. It's revocable.
Well, revocable trust is a living trust. So those Yeah, it's either irrevocable trust or it's a revocable trust, which is the same thing as a living trust. Those two are used simultaneously, like, you know, interchangeably.
Okay, okay. Okay, thank you.
Uh-huh. And then Mr. D. Wong said, do you do living trusts? Yes, our firm does handle living trusts. How come some investors use trusts instead of LLCs if they're teaming up to purchase properties? Is that from you, Annie?
Yeah. So I just don't know, like, why do they choose a certain way to hold their properties for either trust or an LLC when they're buying a property like this?
A lot of times, unless it's like an irrevocable trust, I think a lot of times people just a lot of investors still like don't like creating LLCs for some reason. I think it's because they just don't want to pay the taxes and go through the corporate formalities of it. So they decide like, hey, I don't really care about a living, like for limit, like liability protection, because I'm simply going to hold it and I'm going to live in it for my kids, right? So for a lot of times for living trusts, a lot of clients typically put their primary in it to protect, to avoid probate, right? In which case, if you're the one living in it, you really don't necessarily need the liability protection, because typically you do that for like for lawsuits against like creditors and for tenants, right? Especially in California, because a lot of tenants like to get crazy. So that's the purpose of creating the LLC on it, is a lot of times for that protection, the liability protection, which you don't need if it's simply going to be a primary that you simply just are creating or going to be creating a trust to avoid probate for.
And then I hear sometimes people like combine for asset protections with LLCs and a trust. How, mm-hmm. What does it mean by that? Are they like having the trust own LLC or like?
So a lot of times for the, like typically, this isn't all like the, like always the situation, but for most of the times, the people that have the whole like LLC and trust combo is because they want both the best worlds, meaning they want to avoid probate and they want liability protection. Because sometimes what people do is they'll rent out properties, right? But they still want to put that property in a trust so that you can still get like this, like, you know, so that they don't have to have like the tax, like the property tax, they're reevaluated, all that stuff when it gets inherited by their heirs. So by creating a living trust and an LLC, you're protecting yourself from like your tenants filing a lawsuit against you, right? And your personal assets. And then you're also allowing that property to be put in a trust so that you can avoid probate. Because if you have it in an LLC, you don't avoid probate, obviously, right? So they want it to like, they want that extra, they want the double combo of avoid probate, get liability protection, which is why they're creating an LLC and trust.
So they also have like the umbrella holding company. Would it be like the trust would be the top of the top, then it's the holding company, and then the baby LLCs underneath?
Yeah. So that depends on every individual situation and what they want. You would often see sometimes people have the trust be like at the top. Sometimes it's like a mix, like it's a huge holding company that owns LLCs, that owns trusts. There's a holding company that owns trusts that have LLCs within it. But the most common is usually when is more so the LLC is owned by a trust.
So it's still on the top. Got it.
Because what you're wanting is you want that typically in the layout is like the LLC owns this rental property, right? So in case somebody sues you, you're kind of limiting liability to whatever is just on the LLC itself. And then some people have like multiple LLCs for different rental properties that are actually all held under this trust. More often, it's usually like LLCs, holding company, than a trust. And the holding company and all these LLCs are for like the liability protection, extra layers. And then, but then, cause they ultimately want it all to funnel up to the trust for if and when they die.
So if you have the trust owning the LLC, then wouldn't like kind of like the thing about hiding or the veil thing, like it's you really kind of like know who the trust is or who's the owners of the trust,
cause
then you
won't. Yeah, which is why sometimes people have multiple holding companies, right? And sometimes people will create trusts that are anonymous, right?
Oh, you can do that?
I mean, like when I say anonymous, I mean, I guess I shouldn't have used anonymous. I meant they make it more, a little bit harder for someone to figure out who it is. Because for instance, if you just named it like the AL15472 trust, like how will they know it's Annie Lou, right? Or you can even name it like, you know, whatever you want to name it, to be honest.
So I think when LLCs are registered, they have to put the owner and stuff. And but then if the trust is the owner, it'll just be that weird name. When we do the trust, it's not documented anywhere, like the Secretary of State or something.
Nope.
Like
that. I mean, trust comes into effect pretty much when you die. So.
Ooh, that is a sneaky way to hide your identity in a way.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people do it, right? But ultimately, like you said, go ahead.
I'm sorry. A lot of subject to like investors, they do that just so that they can get away with the due on sale clause. They can hide their name. It's harder to find.
As in they pick a random name?
Like, you know, the due on sale clause?
Yeah.
So when they put in the trust, it kind of give them a layer of protection as well.
It does? Mm-hmm. But are they using a fake name or the actual name to do that?
They just use the address of the house and put in the name of the trust. No one knows that who owned that trust.
And this doesn't affect their original loans?
The original loan is in the owner. So they don't, you know, their name is only on the deed. The trust name is on the deed. So the loan is not under the buyer's name because it's subject to. So they get the house, but their name is not on the loan, the mortgage.
Whoa.
Yeah, I mean, that is kind of, so that's one of those things where it makes it harder for them to realize like who, the sub two deal, like who they sold to.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, if the lender still finds out like, oh, why did title change? They can still, you know, elect to have the due on sale clause. So it's just, but people like, you know, when you do these types of sub two deals, you kind of lay on extra like, you know, things that you can do to kind of make it a little bit harder for them to find. But it's like even just regular, not even due on sale purchases, right? Is when you sell property or sometimes when you change title, typically lenders can accelerate, right? And enforce their due on sale. But as long as mortgages are paid most of the times, I mean, things have changed a little bit more because of the interest rates and now insurance company, like lenders are more strict. But it used to be where they don't care as long as someone's making all the payments, right? It's just
and
always
it's
like
easier to change the name on the trust than, you know, the name on the title. Technically, they can change the name of who owned the trust in there if it's happened instead of,
but,
you know.
But I think that strategy is more so because if lenders see that you changed title to a trust, they won't necessarily know if that trust is owned by that individual, the original owner, or if it's somebody else, which is why that's kind of a more like sneakier way of doing it.
Yeah.
So speaking of that, though, well, actually, maybe even Trin, you might know. Okay, so say they bought it with that trust. Later on, can they still refinance it back to something normal, like down the road when interest rates are lower? Or do you think you're going to run into problems because of the trust? Totally different name. It doesn't match the borrower or the new borrower.
It doesn't. I mean, they can refinance. They have a power of attorney that they let the owner sign as well when they deed the house to them. So there's a lot of things. It's just creative, you know, investing. That's what I'm trying to get into. So there's so much to learn about. They even do a trust that, you know, because you cannot wholesale a house if it's a short sale. But if you buy with a trust, you can actually change the name in the trust to the second buyer to wholesale it. So there's just so much thing about creative, you know, investing. I'm still kind of beginning to get into it. So that's why I'm not sure a lot of things. But yeah.
No, I like it. I like this topic. This is cool.
The topic of creative financing, or are we talking about operating agreements?
Like it all
sorry, off track.
It's all somehow connected.
No, definitely.
And then I think
that's the thing. That's why it's interesting, right? About real estate is like, I feel like one thing always leads to other things, right? Because you almost have to like think of everything as a whole versus just like one specific thing, right?
So. And then Trin also brought up a word, a vocab, and I don't think I understand what it is. What is a revocable land trust?
Revocable land. I mean, yes. What's your name, Trin? Sorry.
Yeah.
I mean, I can let you take the floor here. if you want to.
You can explain better than me for sure.
No, I kind of want to just, you know, open it up for more, I guess, for everyone to discuss.
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, I wasn't sure. Sorry, I was on mic. Okay. Oh no, I mean, land trusts are just like typically just they're a specific type of trust that a lot of investors will use to try to shield themselves from extra like liability protection. There's also a lot of tax benefits you can receive from creating a land trust versus just a regular trust. But the problem is with land trusts, there are a lot of rules that require you to, for instance, like there's like certain periods of time where you have to make sure that you can't make too many changes to the trust.
Oh, and this is the only time where the two, having Tony and Davis together, is such a really good benefit, because what kind of tax benefits do trusts have?
Definitely, it depends. That's not my area of expertise. So land trust, whoever asked that, well, shoot me an email and we can send a team to research that. Yeah. The one time I got nothing. Also watching videos. Yeah.
That's nice to sometimes stump you. It's kind of fun.
Well, land trust is also like kind of in its like own arena of, you know, it's because even trust itself, there's like people just oftentimes think of, you know, living trust or like I said, living trust or irrevocable trust. Or like irrevocable trust, but there's like so many different types of trusts within those that, you know, people, it gets more detailed and more sophisticated as you, you know, dig deeper into it. For instance, like there's people that have certain types of like dynasty trusts that are for like meant for like people that are like three generations below you, right? And so it really varies. Like land trust typically, it started for like tax benefits and also like to shield yourself from specific liability purposes. It's usually for investors that are simply just putting like real estate investments into the trust. But, you know, that's like a whole nother topic that we can talk about, that we can add to this It Depends series.
Good thing we have you guys once a month. So next month is September. And then so the next one's going to be with Tony. And so Tony, what's topic are we doing next time?
The next month is going to be September. And then, so I'm pretty sure we're probably going to talk about probably quarterly taxes or year end, one of the two. Yeah. Or if anyone else wants any specific free advice, we just make the whole topic for that one.
Yeah, and Tony, tell us more about the cohort, the new class that's starting, because I think there were like some questions in the Facebook group about that.
Oh yeah, so cohort-wise, pretty much just 6 weeks of me and Davis is boring you guys to death, but hopefully get a whole bunch of good discounted advice. So like bringing it to folks from like a one-to-one scale is not possible. So one-to-many is a lot more affordable. So pretty much just going over all the nuts and bolts of being a real estate investor. So from the legal side, stuff as like operating agreements, why you need it, a lot more in depth of also like key provisions. And then from tax side, you know, a lot more things from how to, you know, do your books, your LLCs, which entity structure is right for you, investing with other people, K-1. So, you know, a lot of things on like the 101 that you need to know from a tax and legal side. So that's kind of like the cohort. And then, yeah, it'll be every week that we're doing this through. It'll be a live course. So instead of like, no one actually watches like pre-recorded courses. So you actually have to show up and like be there. So you can also ask questions. So just overall good place that to learn more, essentially.
And what's the schedule like? It's once a week, how many hours, what day of the week?
Yeah, once a week for 1 hour. And then we're just doing it on Sunday, since most people are generally free on those days versus the weekdays are worse. So that's going to be the schedule in itself. And then we'll have like kind of a support group also too. So like if your questions don't get answered during the class, then we'll also have, you know, support within a group.
Yay. And yeah. I heard that you're going to be somewhere on September 23rd. Wonder what that is.
So Miss Annie is the best person for, well, in telling you to do anything in life. So there is the Invest Now conference hosted by Sequoia and Sarah, actually. So if anyone's in the Bay Area, come on out. I'm pretty sure Annie has the hookup for discounted tickets too. So hit up her up. I think we also have, I think the CP dude has a code, but I forgot what it is. So discounted codes there for everyone. Share the love, but it'll be kind of give me some like SareCon vibes. But I think it should be fun to meet a whole bunch of other folks in a whole different realm. And finally in our backyard versus going down to SoCal. So that should be fun. I'm pretty excited there. We'll be boring people again with a quick 20-minute convo about, oh, wizard tax tricks. That's what Annie and I came up with for the tagline.
Annie and Tony came up with it? Or Annie and ChatGPT came up with
Annie,
it?
Annie came up with it all. Yeah. And then, yeah. Oh, and then isn't there a bonfire the next day?
Yeah. So for those who live in San Francisco, we're going to be doing a bonfire on the Sunday afterward. And that's because Super Dave gave me a box of wood. And I'm like, that and the fence that broke at my house in March is still sitting on my grass. And I'm like, okay, I should get rid of this somehow. So we're going to do a bonfire with my broken fence. That'll be at Ocean Beach in San Francisco. And so if those who know where that is, it's kind of near Fulton at the end of San Francisco, around 48th. And then if you guys are early, I have to get there early by 4:30-ish and to stake out a place, but I might be bored and play archery next door because my friend has an archery set. So if you want to join, just come on and just let me know. And Tony's going to be there. And I'm also trying to sweet talk Davis into coming up just to hang out with us that weekend. And then also Nelson will be in town. So come and see him. All right. So maybe you guys have any more questions about this class. Should they hit up Tony or Davis? Or is there a preference? Or is there a LinkedIn?
I also don't know if I mentioned it earlier, but I mean, just to give a little bit more information on land trusts, but I know some investors, they do create it, especially when they just simply want to have one person hold title to it on behalf of the other investors for whatever, like to remain anonymous or for tax purposes for the other members. Because typically for land trusts, one person, it's like almost like a separate private agreement where one person's electing to be like the trustor or the owner of the property, owner of the trust that owns that property, but then all the proceeds or benefits or beneficiaries, there can be like numerous different people. So
those are the
that's why a lot of times you'll hear land trust amongst like investors that are like pooling a lot of money together to purchase like larger properties or commercial properties.
So this person is like the asset manager or the
I mean, it's kind of think about like, I don't want to say like a GP in syndication, but it feels pretty much the person, like it's almost as if like I have a trust that holds title to the property and I'm like the owner of that trust, but secretly like there are other beneficiaries that are kind of like my investors or partners that are only serving as like beneficiaries, so that it's kind of like it's just that trust that owns a property, but the rental income or whatever is going to like trickle down to the beneficiaries, but on title it's just that trust that's owned by me. So and that just makes it easier for like, for instance, with lenders refinancing, things of that nature, because now it's just one person in their trust that's trying to get things versus like having to reveal like all the other members like in an LLC, right? But you know, but yeah, that's, could talk about that another day in more detail. But
cool. Awesome. Well, I'm going to wrap it up here because we've gone a little bit over at 7:22. There's a lot of really good questions this month. So catch you guys again next month for the tax session. See you guys soon. Bye-bye. 안녕. 再见.
Peace out.